Welcome to Tom Libous Reports to You.
We help our kids succeed by encouraging them to read and stay off drugs and alcohol. Our roads and bridges have to be safe when our families travel. It's our responsibility to make sure that everyone succeeds. Hi, I'm Senator Tom Libous. I want to welcome you to my program this week. And I have a very dear friend and special guest, Cindy Gordineer, who is the CEO of the Red Cross. And Cindy, we've been chatting right along here and before the program opened, talking about some of the wonderful things that you and the Red Cross does, not only for the Southern Tier, but certainly for all of New York State. And it's good to have you with us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
That's good. Why don't you just, we're going to get into the whole military program thing, which is pretty exciting because I know about 6 months ago, I didn't realize that you really got into some of these great things. And tell our viewers what the Red Cross does for the military and what you've been doing locally.
Well, that's one of the things I like to talk about because so many people don't realize we're really very involved with the military. They know us for, blood and flood is really as most people know it. So we have always done emergency communications for the military. If you have an unexpected, birth, death, whatever, you can call the Red Cross and they'll get the information to the commander and a decision and backup information about whether the servicemen or women should be sent home or things like that. So that's been something the Red Cross has done for a long time. But as we have had more military presence in other countries and, things like that, we've kind of tried to elevate what we're doing to serve the needs of the military populations. And we also are noticing that with a lot of the returning servicemen and women, that they're having trouble integrating back into the community.
And let's talk about that for a second. You do a welcome home type of event.
Well, we try and welcome the soldiers individually at the airport if we can be notified that they're coming. And sometimes it's difficult to find that information, but we try. They've done wonderful things for our country, and it really seems like someone should be standing there saying thank you, a formal presence. But then if they come back in a group, like a battalion comes back, we just did a deployment event last February. That battalion is supposed to come back this February, and we'll do a welcome home event for them with the families. And
so you'll do the whole battalion?
Yes.
This was done where, at Fort Drum? Or
No, this one was actually done in, the battalion is a National Guard unit that is headquartered across the Southern Tier, and they deployed out of the airport in Horseheads, and we actually did the event right there in Horseheads at the airport. This is pictures of it that you're seeing now, and the families were all there. There was a lunch, the formal deployment ceremony, and then the servicemen and women actually got on the plane, and we were there with the families.
And so you're that flexible. This one was done at
the airport.
Yes.
We have to go where we're needed.
Now, how many volunteers do you need to set up something like this?
Isn't that an amazing picture?
That was
the whole battalion. That we probably had about, I would say we had about 45 volunteers involved in that. Those are mental health volunteers. We did a lot of mental health outreach. That was a pretty stressful day for everyone involved. Mm-hmm. So we had a lot of volunteers that were there and kind of just taking the, the pulse of the family members and the servicemen as they were leaving. This is one of my favorite pictures there with, that was one of our mental health volunteers talking with a soldier before he left.
That's pretty exciting.
It was just heartwarming.
What kinds of needs do the soldiers have and their families when they come home? Obviously, they've been on a tour of duty in Iraq or Afghanistan or somewhere around the world, been away from their loved ones. As you said, there's tremendous mental strain. I'm sure a lot of emotion. What do we do to help that when they come home? What kinds of things do you offer?
Well, it's not just the mental strain on them when they come home. A lot of times when they first come home, there is some help for them with that the military helps them reintegrate a little bit on the emotional side, but then they leave the military. Mm. And that's the part where they need really specific kind of on-the-ground help, things like what are the benefits available to them, what are the educational resources that are available to them, what are the there's a growing number of people returning with post-traumatic stress disorder or traumatic brain injury. And sometimes the family members don't recognize it. Sometimes the person themselves doesn't recognize it. So we're working on, we just started a reintegration program. It's going to be a 12-month program. It meets every month, and it's a compilation of a bunch of different organizations. Lockheed Martin actually is underwriting this this group, and they are working with the family members or the servicemen, and it's anyone who's returned. Now, we had a gentleman who was there from that fought in the Battle of Normandy.
Wow.
So we're integrating 50 years later still.
Wow. Did you have, for instance, you working with other veterans groups,
the Vet Center, Veteran Affairs.
The Red Cross is kind of tying it all together.
Yes.
That's wonderful.
Because we can't do it all alone.
No.
And the needs are big. There's a lot of them. We actually had in the first meeting, which was just 2 weeks ago at our facility of this reintegration group, there was a woman there whose husband is in a nursing home. And it turned out he qualifies to be in the VA home in Oxford.
Right,
she
right.
didn't know that. That is a tremendous savings to her, and through the service to our country, he can be moved.
Well, you know,
there.
We're pretty proud of the Oxford VA home.
Yes.
You know, it's a brand new facility. We worked hard to get it built, and we're actually doing an outreach through our office. Maybe you could be helpful to us.
We would love that.
To let individuals know that the VA home is there, and if you're a veteran, there's an opportunity for you to. Hopefully, if you need it, have some your health care through the Oxford Veterans Home. You do a lot of things for veterans. You had a Christmas Welcome Heroes party, or is that
we
part
do.
Of the
Well,
home
no,
or?
That was part of the, working with the families, the family group,
sure.
because they're home, servicemen are overseas.
Right.
We do cards for heroes. We collect them. You actually signed some for me this year.
I remember that.
And we send them to either veterans here or overseas people who are serving now to let them know that we're thinking about it. We're now doing a Valentine's Day cards to the veterans so that we can make sure that they know that the country is still thinking of them on Valentine's Day and thanks
That's
them.
That's wonderful. You know, you have something you want to show me here.
Well, this is part of the integration program or package. Every soldier who comes to one of our integration programs gets one of these. It's just wonderful looking.
Why don't you hold that right up there? Look at that. So they get one of those.
Yes, and they'll carry it all through the 12-month meetings.
Okay.
And then they started out with a book called Tears of a Warrior, and it's about a family's story about living with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Okay.
It is then there's a folder on the resources that are available to them through the Veterans Center for the first one. We'll give them new things each time. And then the last one is a folder, and it just says Veterans to Veterans, words of wisdom and advice for the returning. So it's veterans who wrote letters about what they experienced when they came back and the things that they wish they had known that they're passing down to soldiers who are now leaving the military, and they can learn.
So you're sharing with each other, and
Because I mean, you know, I didn't serve, so when I talk, I don't have the same experience as them.
Nor did I.
But all of these people, and there's hundreds of pages, all wrote letters so that they could share that information. So it's a great resource. And you know, there's credibility from someone who went through the same things you did.
Well, it's pretty remarkable, too. And, you know, we're at a time now, obviously, there's a lot of turmoil around the world. We're all very concerned what's going on. And, you know, every time I'm at the airport or somewhere, I see a veteran coming home, I do stop up. I thank him or her for their service. And, you know, they always light up when you do that. They have a big smile on their face. And it's nice to say thank you, because what they're doing for us is remarkable.
And all the words in the world aren't going to be enough, but it's got to feel to them like they are not, they're kind of not appreciated a lot of days. And if you can be the one who says, you know, thanks, we really appreciate
it. It's nice to do that. It makes you walk away and feel good, too.
I think that's true. You feel as good as they do.
Yeah. Anything else about our veterans program? I want to talk about disaster relief a little bit, because you do so many things and cover such
you've
a
got
wide
me tearing
area.
Up over
That's
thinking
okay.
About
There's
singing.
Nothing wrong with that. There's, you know, we all have those are happy
it's
emotions.
It's a very emotional.
Very
yes.
happy emotions. Let's talk about disaster relief because you know I think a lot of times the Red Cross is thought of you know, 206 the floods. I learned so much as to how effective the Red Cross really is. I didn't have a clue.
Well, I appreciate that.
Years, my experience with the Red Cross is. In another life, I used to give blood every month regularly, and you know that was my experience with the Red Cross. And then during the flood, it was just remarkable.
Well, we appreciated you giving blood, but you actually went out and spent a day in one of our emergency response vehicles. So not only was Red Cross there, but you came and were part of our response for a day. And I do think you know that gets you on the front line of seeing people who have been affected and how you can help them with such little things, you know. But they need food, they need water, they need insect repellent, they need, you know, little things like that. And they know that somebody cares. and somebody's paying attention.
That was the biggest thing. It was remarkable. You know, we would go into families, as you very well know, and they were devastated, and they were cleaning the mud out of their homes, and you really wondered, you know, should they still even be there? And you would come up with a box lunch and some supplies, and they would start crying because somebody cared about them, and it was a pretty touching and heartful experience for me. And people do care. People do care. They appreciate the fact that someone's thinking about them. And I think it's the same with any of us that, you know, when you get sick or you have a personal problem, we always want to know that somebody else cares a little bit. And when you get that card, like you mentioned, to the soldiers or whatever, it makes a big difference.
I think it's more than what you give them. It's the fact that you showed up and you cared. And that's our job as the Red Cross, is to make sure that people know not only does our country care, but we're going to provide. You know, we really are just showing the empathy of the American public. That's what the Red Cross is. It's not, you know, we'd be nothing without the caring that our country shows and allows us to show, you know, through the Red Cross. And, you know, we have fires year-round.
I was just going to say that.
So,
you know, we talked about the flood that hit us pretty heavily. I was going to say this time of year, I would imagine fires. The Red Cross is extremely busy with fires, and we see some very devastating, especially the heart-wrenching ones where, you know, children are killed in a fire, and it just tears your heart out. How active a time of year is it now for the Red Cross when it comes to fires?
It's always active. It's interesting that, you know, I always think that in February, you know, we get busy in January and February, but last year we had a tremendously busy July and August. We had way more fires. So it really doesn't seem to matter as much the time of the year, although, of course, January and February do seem to be kind of higher.
Cindy, what are some basic things they can do? I mean, they should have fire detectors, and I mean, basic things.
I always use things, I say, you know, it sounds really dumb kind of, but vigilance. Be aware. Don't leave candles burning. Don't have curtains near heaters. Don't use open flames and things, you know, and leave them. There's a lot of things like that, you know, get your chimney clean. Just pay attention.
Common sense. You can eliminate a lot of things.
Yes, but for a lot of people, you know, if you can't afford to feed yourself at the level that you need to, you're not going to have your chimney cleaned, but you need to stay warm, and you're going to use your fireplace to do so. So sometimes, even though we say be vigilant, it really is beyond the means of a family to be able to do so. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of those families, what we find is they don't have insurance. It's a very low percentage of families when we respond.
It's very difficult right now. People are out of work.
It's a struggle for some people. And that seems to be one of those things that you can let go.
Yeah. And some people are just struggling to get food on the table. We only have a little time left because you and I can go on for hours and talk
and
about what you do. Yes, what the Red Cross has done for our communities and our state. If somebody wants to get involved, we've got about a minute and a half left. We always need volunteers, and you don't have to go out and fight floods and fires. I mean, what can people do, and how do they get a hold of you?
You can come in and work in the office. You can make phone calls to clients that have been served by the Red Cross.
This is the number they can reach you.
There's the phone number and the email address or the website that they can go to. But they can do things like that are very kind of planned, and you know, they don't have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to go to a fire. But you know, we have some volunteers with us today here in the Capitol who are doing a display of what the Red Cross does and have a mock shelter open, so you can run a shelter. Maybe you don't go to fires, but you're part of a shelter team or a logistics team.
But we can use you. If you want to volunteer, we can use you. They should get a hold of you.
Blood drives. We can find something for everyone to be interested in that would suit their lifestyle.
That's great to hear. Cindy, thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
As always, you know, we could go on for so long. Maybe you'll come back again. We can talk soon.
I'd be happy to.
Great. I'm Senator Tom Libous. I want to welcome you again for this week's program, and we'll see you next week.